I'm not going to stand on the stage because there's lots of people on it. Isn't this exciting? This is the most people we've had on the stage the whole time I've been in this building. So I'm excited just for that. I'm also excited because we have a super great panel of Belgian game developers and writer and journalist Kate Gray, who's going to host a panel with them. And I'm now going to step away and allow her to take over. Round of applause. Hello, thanks for coming. So today, as Hannah already said, it's me, I'm Kate. I write for a bunch of places, including The Guardian and Waypoint. I write mostly about indie games. So I'm going to be hosting this panel today with a bunch of Belgian games developers. So I think the best first question would be, can you introduce yourselves?
This is on? Okay, yeah. I'm Lindsay Raymakers. I'm now graduating in human-computer interaction. So I have programming background. But since last year, I've been doing one game a month. So I've been doing little game experiments, and yeah, I was also traveling to lots of conferences in Europe, game events and stuff. Yeah, what should I say? I'm living in Hasselt in Belgium. Yeah, I guess that's it.
Hi, my name is Elena, and originally I'm from Belarus, but now I live here in Belgium, and I'm a character artist at Laren Studios. And currently we're working on Divinity Original Sin 2.
All right. Thanks. Hi, I'm Esther. I actually have a background in comics and animation. That's how I got into indie games. I've taught a course in Serbia together with some colleagues on like visual design in games. I think I was part of the organization of the last Global Game Jam here in Antwerp. And I'm actually currently working as a freelance localization translator. So there's that.
Hi, I'm Pauline Marlière, and I am an animation movie director, right now working on my movie Scala, and also I'm a game artist working on Panoptic, a VR game multiplayer, really cool. You can try it.
Hi, I'm Lisa Janssens. I study game art and design at Lucas School of Arts. I make games about personal experiences and emotions and the emotions that came with the personal experiences. Mostly that, yeah.
Awesome. Thank you very much. By the way, if any of you do have any questions, feel free to just put your hand up at any time and I might get to you, I might not see you, so you might have to wave a little bit. Can everybody hear me okay as well? Can you hear everyone? Good. Awesome. Okay. So how did you guys get into doing what you do at the moment? Let's go around that way. We'll swap over each time.
I started out playing lots of video games as a kid, but mostly like Nintendo stuff. And then around the age of 15 or 16, I started playing PC games. I got to know about Steam and thus about all the cool indie games that came with them. And I was really fascinated by indie games. They were something I'd never seen before. And I started studying computer science, fell into a depression. And during my depression, I had a lot of time to think about what I wanted to do with my life. And I realized that I wanted to make games about emotions to maybe help others. I think that's
all. Okay, so I've always played games, but I was an animation student and I was making movie, but at some point I got bored of making movie. Yes, it's possible. And I started doing some game jam with an awesome group of friends, and it was really cool. I could express myself more and I was free in the question of the narrative, I'd say, because I think movies are too linear for what I want to say. And then we had a great game jam back in Cologne, Köln in English maybe, I don't know. Yeah, and we made Panoptic, and since then we are great. We are working on the game, and it's really cool.
I've not always played games because I wasn't allowed to play games as a kid. But then I studying animation, I did not really enjoy working on longer productions or even on short films. And during game jams, I discovered I really like working for games because it's just it's different kind of teamwork. It has a different production speed, and I really enjoyed that. And yeah, I don't know. I'm translating right now, and I think it's like I've had experience in animating and like different aspects of producing games, and I've also had experience like translating, and then I combined those, and I have the same experience like as a localization translator. Like, it's really fun to do this for games, and I really like that it's sort of contributive in nature. So yeah, I'm having fun.
Hey, so my story actually started when I first went to the university, because I never expected myself to be a game artist or a game developer, game designer. I was always playing games when I was a child. I love games, but being like working in games was never an option, primarily because I come from a country where it's not really considered like real career, you know? When you say like, oh, where you do work? And you say games, everybody would be like, oh, well, and so what? Anybody playing that? Well, games for kids, education games. So, well, and I went to study journalism, actually. So I was studying journalism for 2 years. Primarily multimedia journalism, and then I realized that I'll be doing that for the rest of my life, and maybe that's not exactly what I'm very passionate about. So during my second year, I left university and I enrolled at here in Belgium at game development program, digital arts entertainment. And basically, I started all over. I started over all, like my entire bachelor's, and I decided to focus just on creating art and creating art for games. So, and well, after graduation, I stayed and find a job, basically. So, yeah.
Yep. So I used to play a lot of games until I was 18. I went to university. I went to study computer science, and then I had some years where I thought, oh, games are such a waste of time, and they're so, like, you just get addicted, it's not healthy at all. Like, I was playing, like, MMORPGs and stuff, and it was quite an addiction. So I stopped for some years, and then I played Journey, and I was like, oh, okay, this exists. And then I started looking into game development more, and now I'm just, yeah, I would love to make games like Journey, and at the moment, I'm making more like personal games. So I was doing my computer science studies, not really knowing what to do, and now finally I've sort of figured it out.
Cool. Are there any questions at this point? No? We're all good. Okay. So I think what would be interesting is to know how each of your personal experiences have informed the games you make and the games you like in particular.
Oh. The games I make, that's easier to answer than the games that I like the question. For the games I make, I write a lot of poetry. So one of my, like, my interests in game is to do the same thing that you do with poetry, like self-expression and writing about maybe some very dark, not so pleasant stuff, but it's very, like, therapeutic. Is that how you say it? Yeah. Then I want to do that in games as well. So it's basically, I try to sort of write poetry with tiny games. So for example, I made a small game, Compass, about overcoming fears, and it's very abstract, there's no words, and it's like two minutes long or something. And I like to like figure out how this feeling is visualized in a game and how interactivity plays into that. So I sort of try to put some emotional experiences, I guess, into little games. That's how it like bleeds into my work, sort of. With the games I like, I need to think about that a bit more, I think.
All right, well, before I start, I probably need to say a few words about the studio I work in, so everybody kind of get what we are doing. So can you please raise your hands? How many of you heard about Lauren Studios and maybe played Divinity Original Sin 1 or 2? Oh, that's brilliant. Well, yeah, so I guess you guys know what I'll be talking about. Because what we are making, we're making RPGs. And since I'm a character artist, I'm kind of, I can, well, basically create your character for you in a way and kind of give you some options to decide from. And that, I didn't, by the way, I didn't work on Divinity Original Sin 1, I'm working on the second game. So nothing of, like, my art wasn't in the first one. So for the second one, I was making a lot of faces and kind of designs for like options you can choose in character creation. And sort of in this way, I can express some kind of like my ideas of what the player would expect his character to look like. Well, in our company, like, well, I think somebody on Screenshake said that we are AAA. Well, we are kind of not exactly AAA, we're triple I, as we call it. So like, we're still an indie game. And speaking of 3D modeling and creating art, we only have four artists doing 3D modeler in Ghent and four in Canada. So that's not a lot. And you still gotta do plenty of stuff. You still gotta work, like, even if you're a character artist, you still gotta work on props, you still gotta do technical stuff, all of that. So you have a lot of freedom. So basically you can like, just, if you want to put something in game, usually if you like talk with a few people, talk with designers, talk with your art lead, usually you can get your ideas in game. So, well, when I arrived at Lara, that was kind of my goal because I had a couple of interesting art objectives and ideas that I wanted to implement, primarily with character creation, and basically I did. So, yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I'm working as a translator right now, but how that's relevant to games I like and games I've made or worked on is that I really like thinking about meaning and how it's conveyed and like how, I think also my background in comics, how words and images work together, but also how gameplay and visuals or gameplay and storytelling, how it sort of merges together and all serves each other. And I really enjoy games where this has been thought about and this has been made into like a very elegant thing. I think that's like Portal was mentioned here on stage earlier today, and I think that's still a really great example of like how gameplay and storytelling interact. And I don't know, I try to, when I make games, I think the last one I made, I did with Jan over there actually. I really like thinking about like how do the visuals convey the story? How does like some background art contribute to the story? How does sound influence both the gameplay and the story? And like how do all these elements come together? And I think that's just one of my favorite things in games to think about. Like, yeah. So there's that.
In the games I play, what I really like about is always the colors and also the story. And this is what I try to put in my games, I'd say, and in my movie, because you can, I'm making both of them, and you can just strip them apart. They're both part of my personality, and they have to talk to each other. I don't know if you can understand that, but yeah, it's So I like to tell things with the colors. Like you have a great story, but you don't have the money or everything like that to make that in your game. So you use simple things like colors to speak about that. It's something I think there's a lot about my work. So yeah.
I guess for the games I make are generally games that I feel like I need myself, like more therapeutic or meditative games, or games to express how I feel. As in the games I play, I either like very short narrative or just like, you know, unique experiences that just like want to convey a small thing. Either that or games that just help me calm down, help me unwind, such as Animal Crossing or Stardew Valley. I've been playing way too much because it's a world where I'm in control, but not like too much control. I don't have to save everyone. I just like can interact, and they need my help, but they also can survive without me. And I'm trying to make games that sort of convey that as well, like give people a sense of control without overbearing them.
Okay. So I found, especially when I was growing up, that people don't tend to tell you, you can be a game developer, you can work in games. It's a thing that people tend to end up in by accident. That might not be the case, but I'm interested, what did you want to be when you were younger, and how do you think that sort of fed into you becoming part of games?
I don't know. Well, when I was younger, I was mostly interested in like, oh, I want to become a vet and take care of the animals, and then I realized that I'd have to cut them open, and I wouldn't enjoy that. But then I've always been drawing a lot, and I've always been interested in using and doing something with that. But the thing is, as soon as I went to high school, I was in a very, very strict high school, and they kind of pushed that away. Like, art is not an option. There's no future in art. Stay away from art. So that kind of just like went somewhere in the back of my mind, I guess. And then the last year of high school, I spent a lot of time thinking what I wanted to do. And I went through a lot of options, like something with languages or programming or all these things. And I like switched from, you know, choices a lot. And I think it's only later, when I finally had time to think about what I was doing, that I realized that none of that was what I was interested in. I always wanted to be creative and do creative things and find an outlet. And I guess that's how I ended up there.
When I was young, I remember I wanted to be an astronaut. So I think that's why I really love Mass Effect. And No Man's Sky and all the other game space. But I guess that means that I really wanted to discover things, like I think this is what I do right now with the virtual reality. Like, you really discover things. There are not a good path to follow to make games in virtual reality. Just don't make people sick, but yeah, you can. It's a whole new world to create new things you don't even know yet. And let me think about me younger. I was always driven by art, so I just make art until it does something. Like now, it does something. It does good.
I wanted to be a biologist with a specific purpose to do things with genetic manipulation and resurrect mammoths, also possibly dinosaurs. I haven't lost any interest in megafauna, but at some point I realized you could also like study animation and study comics, and this is really cool. And I think it's through animation I sort of rolled into games, going to game jams and stuff, being like, hey, do you guys need an animation? animator. They need an animator. But it's comics that really made me realize that I can't just like draw anything or create any universe, but I can tell anything. Like I can tell any story, and definitely like comics gets really complex when you really start thinking about comics gets really complex when you start thinking about how images and words, but also rhythm and timing and the experience of the reader combine. And I think that was really easily like carried into games as well. Like the way you tell a story, I started thinking about that making comics, and then it just went into games really well. So yeah, I've been talking about this earlier. So there's that.
So I remember it like it was yesterday, but when I was 3 years old, I really wanted to be a unicorn. I saw that it's legit career, and I was super, super obsessed with that. But yeah, okay, when I went to art school, I thought about being an architect, actually. And it was like I went to art school, I wanted to be an art exec, and I wanted to design cloth. Then I, you know, did some dancing classes, I wanted to be a dancer. And then I got to uni, and I was like, okay, I want to be a journalist, basically. But I realized that I didn't see, as I said, like the making games was a legit career, that it was actually a thing. And when I realized how many things you can do as an artist in game, it kind of blew my mind. You know, you can do characters, you can be an architect, do buildings, you can create concept art, you can like basically create worlds and creatures. And I understood that, yeah, that I want to do in life.
Yeah. So in contrast, I never really had like some dream, like, oh, I want to be this, or I want to do this when I grow up. I was more like floating around a bit and like, ah, I'll see when I get there what I'll do. So I got, when I went to uni, I chose computer science out of biology and astrology. Astronomy. Astrophysics, actually. So I ended up in IT because I had like in the back of my mind, because I've been playing games, like, ah, maybe I'll end up in games that way somehow. But I didn't really see any pathway there. It was just like, there was this one course in the third year that was about algorithms in computer games. And I thought, oh, they have some like games related stuff. I'll just go do that and maybe I'll get there somehow. But it took me like a long time to realize, like I started playing guitar around 15 and piano a bit later. And I was also writing a bit of poetry. And it was always about like self-expression and expressing emotion. In my, like, the music I play, I don't compose, but I just play like game music or anime music or something. And it's all like really soothing and like emotional. And it took me a long time to figure out like, oh, that seems to be kind of my thing. And then in games, I started doing that as well, like making some like expressive self-expression in games, basically. So yeah, it just sort of happened gradually. And then 1.5 years ago, I heard about Head Start here in Antwerp, and that just totally opened my world. And since then, yeah. Yeah.
Great. Are there any questions from the audience at this point? No? Still no. That's fine. So, out of interest, do you guys have any role models within games? Someone who, if you met them at an event like this, you'd blush a lot and run away?
Actually, I don't have, like, really like a lot of role models, but Brie Code, she's been programming like Assassin's Creed games, and I recently met her, and like she's now working in her own company, True Love Media. And I remember the first time I met her, I didn't know who she was, and we were just talking at Nordic Game Conference at a mixer about Journey, and I was so excited because Journey is like my favorite game. And afterwards, I read up on her, like, oh, okay, damn, I should have known who she was. And then later, I met her again in Utrecht last year at the conference, and we started talking. And now I just really love what she's doing with her company. They're working on a game called Self Care, and it's just like, oh, yeah. And I had coffee with her, and I was really like, I just asked her like, oh, do you want to grab coffee? And I was like, oh fuck, why would she want to have coffee with me? Like this, yeah, I don't know. And then we had coffee, and it was super great. And I can't think of other role models right now, but that kind of blew my mind, like, oh, well, yeah, she's a person, I can talk to her, it's okay. Yeah.
Well, I also have quite a couple of role models, though I've never met them in person. So for an artist, it's like you just hit art station or Facebook groups, and you basically discover people, discover their work. And you learn a lot from them. And personally, I learned a lot from Shane Olsen, who was a 3D artist at Disney Infinitive, basically. And also, for example, Jean-Troy Nickel and Lina Lazar, who founded I Has Toys. If you haven't seen their models, check it out. It's very nice. And also just like 20 plus artists that I'm following, like on ArtStation and Facebook. They're all very great people, and well, I talked to some of them, like again, like just chatted and stuff. But yeah, I've never met them. I've met like maybe before I arrived to Laren, where I'm working at. I heard and saw works of Maxim Poncelet, who is also a character slash concept artist at Laren. And yeah, I was kind of also like looking up to him and looking up to his work. And when we met, it was more or less very casual. And I think everybody who works in game is generally a nice person, maybe because we're united like by our interests, you know, because like, well, if we make games, we probably like them, so we have something in common already. And it's easier to start conversation, I think. So.
I don't really have like a role model, but I blush a lot at Screenshake because meeting people, because I'm really impressed by everyone. Like I really like meeting people and having like just conversations about making games, because less than like looking up to heroes, I'm really amazed by everyone who's like exploring what can be done with games and what they can tell and what matters to them when working in games and when creating games and when communicating with players. And that for me is the thing that gives me like a lot of energy and a lot of admiration. So it's basically all of you.
Well, I have one role model, yes, at least. It's the artist Matt Rhodes from BioWare. It's a lead concept artist on the Dragon Age series. And he is just a big source of imagination for me, for all the characters I make in my movies and games sometimes. And yeah, I really like what he creates and everything. But otherwise, I don't think I'd brush to him or anyone now, because I had this period when I just started doing games, and you're going to events and you get to know some other developer, and you're like, oh my god, they are making games, and I don't make any games right now, but oh I really like what they make. And you're just too shy to talk to them, and then you finally go through and talk to them. Like, I remember my friend Vaida, she was like one of the people I admire the most, but I couldn't talk to her because, oh my god, her game are so good, I make nothing. but now we're friends, and that's good.
Yeah, there are like so many people that I look up to, especially within the indie game community, and I'm slowly starting to meet more and more of them. It's kind of crazy, like Vaida as well. and also Lindsay, and there was a time where I couldn't imagine like ever talking to them, and now we're friends. And no, it was like they make cool things, and no matter how small or how short, they're still like things. And now I'm doing that too. It's kind of crazy. But yeah, a lot of people that I run into at Screenshake, like I actually look up to you as well. people like Owen Harris from Deep, just like so many people, and then you start talking to them and sometimes they're interested in what you're doing as well. So yeah, it's like ever-growing list actually. Like you go to these events and you see new people and it's like more people to look up to, and meanwhile I'm following like so many people on Twitter. But if to name one person, I'd really like to meet Florian Feldman from Liva Oma, definitely.
So this is going to be a slightly depressing question, but I hope it's got a positive spin on it. What would you say is the biggest barrier to entry that you had getting into games, and how did you overcome it?
Biggest barrier. Well, first of all, it was like more societal things, like things from my school and where I grew up. Art is a very uncertain, thing. Even my parents at first weren't like sure about art. It's like, are you sure you'd want to do that? And you just like put that thought away. And then also I was very self-conscious about everything I did. So it's also like my own barrier, like, is my stuff worth showing? Are people interested in what I have to make? It's mostly that. But now that I'm in the community, people are really nice and people are interested in what I do. So yeah.
I think it's, well, when I was in art school, I had always the, oh no, you're not good enough to make this, you know, you better stop. And it was a really rude world. You just, I kind of fell on depression for a time, and it was just before trying to make games. And yes, it was a really hard time to go through and making art again, because all the people you saw were like, no, you're just not good enough. Just give up and do something else, like I don't know, journalist or sorry, things like that. And I was like, no. I really like my sister, so he's a journalist, so yeah. But I'm trying to make art, and it was hard, but what helps me is that I went to some game dev event meeting, again, and meet people that give me trust on me, and so I started making art again, and making games, so. And I completely didn't listen anymore to anyone from my old school, and I just make my stuff, and it was fine at the end. So yeah, that's my experience.
I think for me it was just getting into the environment and like showing up and keeping showing up, maybe like. Like coming from an art school, they were like, okay, games aren't very highbrow. It's very trashy, or like, is this like Nintendo stuff, right? And it was very weird because like, I think like your animation teachers, for example, are not connected to video games at all, even though there's great art being made in them, and there's like a lot of really exciting stuff happening, and there's also work in games, but like. Yeah, I don't know. I wouldn't have gone to my first game jam, which is, I think, a really good entry point for people curious about working in games, if like a friend of mine who was already working in games hadn't invited me, and he was like, okay, you really should come. And I think it was like the second year he was asking, because I was like, oh, there's going to be game people? this was a good call. But I think like these like low entry points or easy entry points like game jams are really important for people to like enter a community, because
if you're not very connected with games, or you don't grow up connected with games, but you do maybe feel like you would have a good place there, it's really hard to get in there. And yeah, I don't know, game jams are good, and there should be more of them.
There you go.
Yeah. So for me, the hardest kind of thing was judging your work. And I don't think it only applies to artists, but also to like anything what you're doing. It's very hard to judge like your things, you know, like your kind of baby that you produced. It's really hard. But what you need to do, you need to like kind of put like yourself out there. And even if you are best at your art school, it doesn't necessarily mean that you are best like in Belgium or in the world. It probably means that there is not much competition out there. And for me, the hardest kind of thing was realizing that I'm not good enough and I need to invest more time and to work even harder to be good enough to get into the game industry and to do the quality, to produce like the quality, the very high quality art pieces, basically.
For me, the biggest barrier was basically not having a community to like exist in, let's put it that way. I was studying computer science and there was no one around me making games. Like some people were like trying to do some stuff, but there was like not really anything. And I wasn't on Twitter either, which is also really, yeah, helps you a lot. So I went to like Head Start here in Antwerp, and it was a 7-week program. And we were just doing like workshops and stuff. And there I met some amazing people. They're here as well, a few of them at least. And yeah, from there on, like you just, once you find some people and you get on Twitter and you connect to more people and you go to more events and just show up somewhere and you'll meet people like constantly, and then you can connect over like what you're most passionate about. And that's really what keeps you going. Like for me, that's how I keep doing what I do, like meeting people who are interested in the same thing. And before that, I was just like, I don't even know like what people are making in games. Like I had no idea about the indie community in Europe or in Belgium or anywhere. So then it's really hard like to get yourself to make games. Like if you have no one around me, because you have to motivate yourself, and like where do you put it if you make something? It's like on your hard drive, that's it. So it also really helps to just put stuff up on itch and just tweet about something that you're making, and then people are like, oh, this is nice. And just, yeah, that's really what got me and what still keeps me going, basically. Yeah.
Awesome. So which countries and cities in the world do you think are great for indie game development, and why?
Cities in the world. At the moment, I'm mostly looking at Berlin. I've heard a lot of great things about it, that there's a vibrant like indie games, alternative games, my kind of thing. And I'm also looking to an internship there, so maybe I have a little bit of a bias that I want to go there. That's a tough question. I've only been to like some European cities, so I can't say anything about like outside of that. But I was in Copenhagen for a few events and in London, and there seems to be like communities everywhere, which is really great. So I guess it's more a matter of finding like which community is like doing the things that I'm interested in, and then going there maybe. For me, that's at the moment Berlin, I suppose.
I think everywhere where you can find a good internet connection would be fine. Yeah, and why? Well, because I think right now games are all about getting like it out in the world, and don't focus on just like local audience and like just people around you. I think you need to like look at the bigger picture and socialize, get on Facebook, get on Twitter, and yeah, just get a good internet connection. You'll be good.
When I was teaching games in Belgrade in Serbia, one of my colleagues contacted people at Steam, and he was like, yeah, we're teaching this course, and it's to like, I think a lot of people in Serbia feel a bit like disenfranchised about their future, like growing up in an Eastern European country. And a lot of them are looking at immigration. I don't know, the guy contacted Steam is like, help us out. We're trying to give these people some perspective. And people at Steam were like, we really can't give you any money. but what we got was this letter from Gabe. And the letter was basically saying like, hey, just to encourage you guys, like, anywhere with an internet connection right now, like wherever you are in the world, you have an opportunity. And I think that's like, local community is important, but keeping that in mind, that currently where you are matters a lot less than like 10 years ago or something. This is a really exciting prospect. So yeah, that.
Well, I agree with the internet connection. It's just so much easier to meet people like that and even create games without knowing the person you have in front of you. It's really good. Otherwise, I haven't traveled a lot to, say, one city in particular. Maybe Antwerp, thanks to the House of Indie, but I don't think of any other city right now.
Yeah, I don't know like too much either about the other communities within the other cities or countries. Berlin, I'm also very interested in. There are like really a few really good studios there. But I was surprised like how big the Belgian game community can be, and how tight the people are. Yeah, everyone's really friendly towards each other, and you help each other out, and that's, yeah, I don't know where I would be without that. Nowhere, probably.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you very much for those answers. We've got 5 minutes left, so maybe time for one or two questions if they're very short answers. Does anyone have any questions they'd like to ask? Anyone? It's not a very brave audience today, but that's fine. Okay, I'm going to repeat that again for if there are cameras recording. Can you tell us about the game that resonated emotionally with you?
I need to think about that.
We can stop this. And
yeah. Does anyone know the answer yet? Yeah. Well, I recently played The Witcher 3, which I loved. And I loved the story, and I think it's it was kind of like a small breakthrough in my gaming experience that the story and the quests could be so good, you know? Because usually you just give a game a slag that like, oh, well, they have great visuals or they have really nice combat mechanics. But in Witcher 3, I really liked the story and it was such a great an experience for me. So, yeah. Anybody?
The most recent example I can think of is Gone Home. I basically spent the entire game like rooting through the house with this sense of concern for this sister person, like, oh my god, what happened here, and are they okay, and is everything okay, and like the entire game I had that sustained feeling of concern, and like that really impressed me, so yeah.
For me, that has to be Gravitation. It's by Jason Rohrer. I never know if I'm pronouncing that right, but it's a very small and short game. It's like 6 minutes. It's very pixelated as well. It's actually a game about parenting. There's like, you're an avatar and there's like a little kid. And it's very abstract, very much like a poem actually. That's why I like it. But what I saw in it was showing basically like a lot of mood changes in the visuals. And to me, I saw depression in there, like going from happy periods to feeling like very dark. And that was like just 6 minutes, but I was just like crying like, oh, damn, I want to make things like this. Yeah, that's what really resonated with me.
For me, it's Journey, just because, yeah, obviously, like a lot of people, I think, you don't have to speak to be understood, and just I don't think I really need to say something because, yeah, journey. you just feel the game. It's an experience you just go through, and you live the moments in harmony with the character, and you feel their emotions, and it's really transcendent. It's the best for me.
I guess the first game that first indie game that left like a really big impression for me was Papers, Please. Mostly because it provokes emotion a lot through the game mechanics itself, and that was new to me. I did not know that was a thing that existed, that games could do that. And then after that, I just started looking up so many games, and it's hard to choose. Also, Animal Crossing in an odd way, because it helped me a lot during tough times.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, those were all great answers, and that's all we have time for. So it's a good note to end on. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming. Thank you. And a final thank you to Kate Gray for hosting so eloquently and all your brilliant answers.